Hello everyone, I'm Overhaul, and today we'll be talking about My Hero Academia chapter 235. I know it's been a while, but you know, since this chapter was released, but I must talk about it. So yeah, we finally get to see Tomoe's backstory in basically full. I mean, the only thing that I left ambiguous is a theory, which I will briefly talk about it, and the dark part of the backstory, the murdery part. So yeah, let's begin with this chapter. We begin this chapter where we left off in previous one, with Skeptic informing Rudasho, "There's a beast! Rudasho, for your safety, get away!" Basically panicking. And Rudasho is, although he has Skeptic on, he's not focusing on what Skeptic is saying. He's looking at Tomoe, he's like, "My stress bombs. I was developing those things since my childhood." Might be a problem with translations, but then again, it might not be. He's like, "How was he able to deflect them? I mean, as soon as that touched them, he was able to decay." I'm assuming that the way stress bombs work is that he just swings his fist at an opponent and that pushes them away or something. Like, Rudasho's quirk doesn't really seem to be a energy type quirk. Maybe we'll explain later, because I don't believe we got a full list of explanation how it works. But yeah, anyways, Rudasho's like wondering how, why, and he also mentions the fact, why would someone whose only desire is to destroy everything would have such a instinction that he would wanna, that he would survive that, to give him that boost to survive my stress bombs. I won't say the Rudasho is dumbfounded by this, but he is like wondering why. Doing why. So yeah. And then Tomoe has this, I believe these panels are supposed to be kind of inside his head and what he's saying, which are two different things. And we basically have Tomoe say, "Well, what I want is, like you said, I want the structure of everything." And some other things that really relate to that. And Rudasho is like, "Then you must die, because a future with no someone doesn't want to create that, isn't good for a future, or something, or just things that he wants to create something, and Tomoe wants to destroy everything." And Tomoe is "Since when do we need a future?" Now, I kind of find this to be, this battle between Rudasho and Tomoe to kind of be the fight between what's battle motivation. Is it battle for someone? Is a villain battle that has a motivation that's, we fix something that's wrong in the world? Or is a better villain, even if the villain just wants to destroy everything? I kind of feel this kind of to be kind of contrast between the two. Because, you see, some people in the fan base of My Academia don't really like the fact that the only thing that Tomoe wants to do is to essentially destroy everything, excluding his allies and what they want in the world, but mainly he wants to destroy everything. Some people find that kind of a bland, kind of a bad motivation, but for me personally, it makes sense. Plus, in his backstory, if you look at it, it makes sense what he would want. It's the same way how Rudasho's and Stain's backstories make sense for what they want. I'll explain the end of their backstory. But yeah, Rudasho like charging in at Tomoe. Now, we don't know if he's at 100% form, because that form that he's in does seem to be a bit more complete than the 80%. It might be just the way it's drawn, or maybe it's just that with Dash, or maybe it's just because with Dash's mouth can always be closed, just he didn't close or something. I don't know exactly. But yeah, he charges at Tomura, and I believe he puts his father's hand on his face, which we get this cool panel, these two cool panels with him, saying, with him just being without any of the lightnings and bling, like he's pure white, like putting it on. So yeah, we get them, and now we get the full flashback. And I even believe that it's the name of the chapter is something like Shimura Tomura Shigaraki or Tanko Shimura Origins. So yeah, we get to see a panel, which I will briefly talk about, in which a man that kind of fits into what we've seen of flashback all for one, bringing Tomura back and telling his mother something that he did when he was pretending to be a hero. Alright, let's talk about this. I will talk about the whole All For One theory that he's the reason why Tomura got a quirk and those lines. I will talk about it. I don't know when, maybe a bit later, or maybe on Halloween, because I am planning on making All For One video on Halloween time, because he's kind of fits him. But yeah, I'll talk. So yeah, this character does kind of fit to what he looks like. But I feel like if that is All For One, we're going to get that revealed in this arc, because Tomura stated that he remembers everything. And he does remember. So this means if that is All For One, I'm sure that Tomura will be able to put the dots together. In fact, I believe the gap of times is only like a couple of days. So I wouldn't be surprised. So I believe it will be mentioned by Tomura. So yeah, anyways, this man that we don't know who he is, brings Tomura back, and Tomura's mother, who we don't find her name. Maybe her name is in the chapter just because of the translations, we don't know, but anyways, Tomura, she says to him, thank you, we will be sure to correct him or something. Now, I don't believe we find out what he did. It says that he was pretending to be a hero. So maybe there was like a incident, he pretended to be like a hero and got in trouble with it. Similar to how Deku was in the beginning of the chapter, where he like rushed to help his friend when it comes to a villain, but it wasn't a police officer or a hero. It just seems to be a random civilian with a cap on. So we don't exactly know. But anyways, that whole thing gets slayed because that douchebag parent comes along, and this is Kotaro Shimura. I believe it's Kotaro. I believe it's Kotaro. Shigaraki's father. And he comes and he was saying he was again being a hero, pretending to be a hero, or playing a hero. And, you know, he grabs and drags him away. In which to both his wife and Tomura, they're both like, no, don't do it, his allergies. Like, no, please let me go. Basically panicking. And yeah, he's basically the douchebag parent as we all thought. But not completely what we originally thought. You see, originally we thought that Tomura and his father were like alone, and Tomura's father was abusive, which he still is. He's not, but he's not in the same reasons why we fought previously. It's different. I'll get into them later. And we thought that they were poor, but no, he's actually a rich businessman and he has a big house. It's just he's still abusive, and yeah, we get into that later. So yeah, he says, if you wanna teach a child something, you need to do it the hard way. You know, the basic douchebag parents ways. And he puts Tomura outside. And when I say outside, I mean backyard, to be there for hours. Not for hours. He puts him outside until he comes in and apologizes. Which I'm guessing means when he decides to go outside and talk, ask him, are you feeling sorry for what you did? Because I don't know if you can hear through those glasses. I feel like that you wouldn't want to hear through. But yeah, they basically, Thomas' mother basically comes to him and says to him, we begin with Kotaro's being saying, don't let him in until he apologizes. And then she comes, but the dinner is ready. And his allergies are getting worse. And he's like, this house has rules and we must abide by them. So yeah, we get to see kind of the family dynamic with the Shimura or family, whatever we want to refer to it. So we find out that the one rule that this family household has, and that is not talk about heroes. Don't say you're gonna become one. Basically, if you think that a normal household like Bakugos, Dakus, and everyone like that would be where they talk about heroes, do not. Don't talk about them, don't pretend play them, not think heroic at all. And we kind of see that he and the rest of the family, like his wife and, well, mother and father-in-law, are not really liking it, but they don't do anything because, well, it's stated that he's the one who built this family. This house and everything, so he's kind of the one that's in charge of the family. Also, he's kind of drawing a way that you would think that the head of the household would kind of look like. He like sits down and says, the rules are the rules, right, mother and father? Which might be, again, translation error, but he's referring to him not like completely mother and father, even though they're in laws. And they follow the rules. So yeah. Oh, by the way, one note on Tomoshiki's young age, Tomoshiki's childhood. Shigaraki looks has black dark hair, which could just be something wrong that Hakoshi made, or maybe he just wanted to show how Daku and Shigaraki kind of look similar when they were age 5, and the fact that we find out that at that age that Tomoshiki is only 5 years old. So yeah, and we also find out that Shigaraki still didn't have a quirk. Yep, interesting. And Kotaro just says something, it's unusual for a person at 5 years to not have a quirk. So I'm only giving him something, a reminder that the world is cool. So if he doesn't learn the world is cool by this way, he will find out later and he will not be prepared. So yeah, now I'll discuss the whole if he was quirkless or if he's a very late bloomer because 5 years old. Which is kind of weird. 5 years old, that's the gap? That sounds weird. But yeah, anyways, it's not good. Then we get another scene with Shigaraki and his mother, which in the previous chapter was kind of off with the mother because in the when she was drunk, kind of seemed like she was not really a big fan, but like kind of bored and irritated. But it seems like she is, but no, she does love him. It was just because it was drawn in a weird way, or maybe no, I just misinterpreted it. But anyways, they have a little talk about it, and Shigaraki is like, why does that not allow me to be a hero? Is it because he hates me? Because you're willing to look at Tomoe, he needs to like, he doesn't understand that the reason why he acts this way is because of Kotaro's mother, Nana Shimura. How he doesn't even know Nana's name. I don't even believe he knows her name. So yeah. Yeah, and then mother tries to comfort him and says to him, no, he doesn't hate you. He just doesn't like it. He doesn't understand. So yeah, and then Tomoe tells us a little bit about his child, how it is in the playground or in school. Well, not school, I think it's called kindergarten. So he says that two names that I don't know if they're gonna be referenced. I think it was Miku-chan and Toko-chan or Tomo-chan. I don't know exactly. But he's like, they don't let me play with them. And I don't know why. Is it because I don't have a quirk yet? Or is it because I itch or something? But it's comparing me to All Might. All Might. Which is another thing you can kind of do, another thing to kind of contribute to the comparisons between Tomura and Shigaraki a little bit more. More if you really think about it, than just being two sides of the same coin. So yeah. Yeah. Look at that. Also, imagine that the itching that Tomura has, it's something that hasn't been found by anyone. Now, the translations that I read didn't say anything about the doctors. Because let's be honest to ourselves, there are multiple ways for her to get the medicine. Medicine from people. Find out the medicine for itching. I mean, for example, go on internet, find that, right, type in something, medicine for itching. So, but yeah, they don't know. But most likely, it was just a translation. They most likely go to doctors. Although I am questioning then how come they didn't check it to see if Tomura does have a quirk. Because Tomura's quirk does seem to be manifest. Does seem to be kind of manifesting because of the things we see there in the chapter. But yeah. Then after the ad scene, we get to see the already flashback with Hana showing the picture of Nana. Huh. Kind of funny that Hurota hates his mother or doesn't like him, his mother calling her Deva, in fact. And that he names his daughter with only changing one letter. Kind of fun, ironic. But yeah. She like shows him his picture and he's like, even though that doesn't like it, I will cheer you on becoming a hero. Like Deku. And she's like, we can be even superhero siblings. Which I do wonder why that's not a popular thing. But yeah. Yeah, basically she's cheering on, she's been a good big sister. And yeah. Then we get to see a scene where Tomura smiles and he's back in the dark. He's like, mother was a hero too, huh? Grandmother was a hero, huh? And he's happy. Then he throws the ball the dog has and he like feels pain in his hand, which kind of references the whole quirk. Manifesting thing. I am wondering if all quirks, when they manifest, feel certain pain in their body. Because I feel like the only time we've seen that was with Kirishima, Bakugo, and Deku? Maybe someone else, but I'm pretty sure these are the only ones, and Kirishima already hurt himself because he cut him, and Bakugo, I don't believe, started just randomly exploding. And Deku, well, didn't exactly need to have any feel pain because it was a transfer, but yeah. But Tomura feels pain in it. And then Kotaro shows up. And the way it's basically described is like the tension between the anger that comes from Kotaro and to Tomura is like piercing his skin. I even believe they mentioned that his skin's actually a bit dry or something. I don't know, it's like, he's screaming, like, you went to my office, you little, he doesn't say you little, but basically he would say you little shit or something on those lines. And he is like, and Kota's like, super pissed. I think even Endeavor would have more emotions in the flashbacks that we got with him. And he just like gets ready and slaps his son's face. That Tomura's face. And he probably slaps him some more. I mean, the only thing we see from it, from there, is just seeing the family in which Tomura's like, What? Stop just staring there and crying. Come and help me. In which he also so kind of see how the reason how he knows that, and that's because Hana told not really Rana tomorrow out. She told him he just wanted to see the photo. Basically, the way how I can imagine it is Hana may have not been as careful in concealing the evidence that they were there, and then he came and asked, "Did what happened?" Maybe he did show Hana the picture or something, because she did seem to know that somehow. So maybe he came to her and like grabbed her by arm or something, because remember, she is only older than 5. And even that at best, she could just be 9 months older. Not even a year apart. I mean, if she had birth in June and 9 months later, she could still be... January, and she could, yeah, still not, there couldn't be a very big gap between the two. So he just starts slapping at, so yeah, they just cry, and Tomokai makes a reference to that, saying like, how resolve is absolute, or children can be so selfish or something. Which does make me wonder, because there are some moments between that when we get this like older Tomokai telling the story. So I am wondering if he's actually telling this to Redastro, or if this just in his head, like he's telling his story, he's explaining everything, it's just a couple of the moments we only see the moments with him telling that part, because Redastro previously mentioned a bit of his story, so maybe Thomas as well explaining what he does to Redastro. We don't exactly know. And we may not even find out in the next chapter. We don't exactly know. Tomoya is a lot of pain. And then we cut to sometime later. I feel like after... Now, I believe the day that Tomoya was starting to be beaten by Kotaro was still... middle of a day, I would say. Not too late. Probably around, let's say, 3 a.m. Or is it 3 p.m.? I was like, it's somewhere midday. And now it was dark, in which we see Kotaro in his office, like, taking the picture of Hana and looking at him, them being together and reading the letter. And we find out that Hana was sad about leaving him behind. Like, Shimei Alana says, "I'm sorry for leaving you behind, but you see, I have some very bad people trying to battle with. So if I would have you, they will come after you, and I don't want that. But even if you hate me, just you know, I will always love you." So yeah, this type of a letter. And now he mentions that, man, if at least you hated me. Because the way that Kotaro views Hana is that he views her as a demon. In fact, he tells Tomura that being a hero is a person that just throws away their family just to save some random people. Like, they will save people, everyone else, but their own family, the people they gave, well, not us, Chase, birth to, because because of, you know, biology, but still. They will give birth to... to you, but they'll throw you away just so they continue saving people, which is like reason why Oma doesn't have a wife or children. So yeah. And then we cut to his wife's family, all of them except Han, I believe, coming into his office, and they're like, "We need to talk about something." And he's like, "I went too far, didn't I? Where are they?" Which does seem to be implying that he also did something, nowhere near as bad as he did to Tomoa, but he did something to make her spill the beans and try to make it sound as little punishment of her as possible. Maybe he just grabbed her by hand strongly and she screamed. Krim because she was crying her eyes out. So maybe he did something and he and they're like, alright, we cannot live like this. We cannot live with you. Every time they mention they want to be a hero or pretend to be a hero, or every time they do something hero related, for you to just come there and start beating the two up and throwing them outside to spend as many time until you come out and apologize. Until they are forced to apologize. Because let's be honest with ourselves, how many people here would actually want to stay the entire night outside? So yeah. And also the reference that he wants to make a happy family. And this is anything but happy. Which is true. I mean, Kotaro Toma's dad is a douchebag in all means. But he does want to have a good family, a loving family. But his methods are horrible. Like, I would say he's amongst those people who say they want to have a happy family and a happy house and doing everything good, but they do that in the worst fucking possible way. So yeah, good wish, but a horrible way to apply, like, despicable. I'm talking the worst dad of the year reward. Also, by the way, when I was watching some other people's reviews of this chapter, there were some comments below saying, Endeavor, I'm the worst father. Kotaro, hold my beer. I mean, again, it's not exactly a funny matter because those two are horrible parents, but it's kind of funny, you know, if you don't include the horror part. So yeah, basically they're saying we cut to Toma now and he's like crying and itching and basically the worst thing going on, and his quirk manifests just as he says, I hate everything, which is mostly the main reason why Toma wants to destroy everything. So yeah, now we don't know if his quirk manifests that just yet. We just get patting the dog or whatever it's called. And then we get a close up of the dog's eyes and it is ooh, like in pain. And I hate everything. So we would assume this mean, so we are, and so we assume this is the part where the dog's quirk, Toma's quirk manifests and kills the dog. Something that some people here would like. So yeah. And we don't see anything else. Like, we don't know if... Well, we know that he kills the rest of the family later, but we don't get any more information, like, seeing him going to the family and touching them with all five fingers and killing them all. We don't see that. We only see the dog seemingly to die and Toma saying, I hate everything. So, yeah. The two main things I took away from this chapter... His first thing, which is the obvious thing, I'm really trying to show how Tomoa and Deku, they are kind of like the same, they kind of have a similar backstory, but switch in two different ways. For example, both of them are young kids, 5 years old, kindergarten, and which their friends or the group they hang out a lot of the time, All of them didn't really like them very much. They would push them away and, you know, not being the best people to them. But to them, which we had Deku with Bakugo and the other guys we completely forgot. And we had Toma with the other two, we don't know. Maybe they're gonna be relevant later in the arc, maybe we're gonna meet some other characters that are gonna mention Toma or something, we don't know exactly. But yeah. They were not in a fan groups. The differences will come from the fact that Deku had only his mother, while Toma did have his entire family. But while Deku's mom was loving and full of love and how even Alco's father just seems to be out in the sea, and he is taking a very, and he can't come to visit. Of time doesn't seem to be implying there's anything bad, any bad blood between the guys. Well, Tomoya had a big family, but his family was not the worst, but the worst one of the worst fucking people that isn't a villain, as a father, who is mostly the one that holds the family, who is most the one that's who's in charge, with a sister who does love and support him, but her father, is so horrible that she would not want to be hurt by him. With mother and her parents being the ones who are just gonna accept it and not like it, but they will very begrudgingly kind of allow it. But so yeah, that's a few comparisons. It's also the fact that they had been given the quirk a lot later than the period that was supposed to begin. Now, Toma is, I believe, 4 years older than Deku, so I believe that was still a bit... So I believe that might have still been a time where it wasn't completely uncommon to find a person with no quirk, but still. Still, it's not exact, but considering the fact Hana may have a quirk, I would think that that Shigaraki would one of these few cases where even if you're 5 years old, you can still get a quirk. But again, I feel like considering the quirk he got, he probably would not want a quirk if it was a possibility. But yeah. Yeah, and also, both Deku and Toma were inspired by All Might to be heroes. It's just... the results were not exactly what we all thought. In fact, you know, there's a popular thing in My Hero Academia where they would like to make a villain Deku, or Izuku, whatever you want to call it, evil Deku, I believe is his villain name. Which I would like to know where that thing became from. Like, was it to Izuku's original design, because it does look kind of villainous? Or was it his backstory would kind of fit into a backstory of villain or something? I don't know. Because Toma's backstory is basically, take the tragic part of Izuku, or the parts that really make you feel sorry for Izuku, and make them about Todoroki level. And so Todoroki level, I mean, put the horrific parts from that, for Todoroki, the horrific levels of Todoroki, and increase them with Deku's to make Tomoa's. So yeah. And the second thing that to mention is that in this backstory, we find out exactly why Tomoa having anything else except way to destroy everything doesn't make sense. Let me explain. You see, if you look at some of the other backstories for people like Stain and Ridastro, you can see why they are doing what they want. Stain was inspired by All Might in the same levels as Izuku and Tomura and Bakugo. But unfortunately, when he came to UA High School, he found out that he was about the only one who's doing this because of being a true hero. So he decided to quit being a hero because he didn't want to be with these people who would be, you know, so disrespectful of the title, and decided to just tell everybody about it, his masters, and they just go on a killing spree. Makes sense. With Dashers makes sense because it was his grandmother that died such a horrific fate. And his father is like, he agreed with his father's ideals completely, because they do kind of fit how most of the world would like to work. And he lived by those ideals by having the book and read it and a lot of things like that. But Tomura's backstory cannot fit in either of the two because the Hero Society, or the bad parts of the Hero Society, like which ones are the heroes that are abusing their positions, the heroes for gain of money. I guess Hawks, and I think Monk Lady, and I think there's some of those, but I can't really remember them. Those type of heroes were not the reason why his life sucked. Honest to God, the heroes that really you could blame for the for his life sucking or being so horrible is All Might, being the true heroes. So technically, Toba should be going out and saying, true heroes cause nothing but pain. They may be good and say that, but every enemy or friend comes from them only is 10 times worse. Which is kind of true. I mean, a battle of a hero it is, the enemies are usually 10 times worse than a regular one. So that doesn't make sense why he would want to change the Hero Society. It doesn't make sense why he would want to change the structure of society by their quirks, because honestly, his quirk was just a method of killing his entire family, and who in the heck would want to be in a play, would want to have a quirk that kills his entire family? Who? Put your hand down, you psychopath! So yeah, nothing on those levels. And then it doesn't make sense why he would want to have revenge on his family, because he kind of already had that. So Toma wanting to destroy everything is kind of the only thing that Toma would really want. I might make a better video about this, getting my full thoughts on the desires of villains or the motivations for villains, but that's what I think right now. Overall, this chapter was good. I'm happy with finally getting this flashback flash out, not completely, by about 95%. And I am wondering what will happen next. Are we going to continue the flashback? At least get the parts where he kills and how his family, or if we're just going to get back to him fighting with Astro, or are we gonna cut to some of the other fights like Twice vs. Skeptic, Trumpet vs. Spinner, Apocrypha vs. Dobby, especially Apocrypha vs. Dobby. Or are we going to go on Gigantomachia rampaging chapters? We don't know. Maybe Mr. Compresca versus a hero. Or something. But yeah. So far we don't exactly know. No. Well, how we're gonna continue this, but it's our break, so that's a good thing. Now we can continue, so which means we are going to have to wait for a week. Patches, it's killing me! It's killing me! I think it's actually decaying me. I'll deal with that later. Now anyways, I hope you liked this video. I hope you're gonna leave a like and comment below on what you think. Now anyways, I hope to see all of you next time. Bye.